Well, I wasn't actually expecting to speak to anybody like this. My name is Carol without an E, Woods with an S. My title is Ms. The ladies about the passports, etc., it is all entirely true. I do not exist. You can't see me, you only think you can. Lancashire Police have reinvented me as a non-existent person because I am dead. Now, they suggested I was dead in September 2006, and they then went on to wreck, seize, and loot my entire assets. They knocked £70,000 off the value of my house in one afternoon because the trade was I give them certain documents and I get to keep my house. To wreck my house, they ripped out the whole ground floor expensive double glazed windows and they wrecked my lovely stained glass period front door. Now, I can talk about anything and all this, anything at all. I cannot talk about the house because I get upset. So they invented a trustee to deal with the house matter. The house was my punishment for blowing the whistle and refusing to kowtow and bow down. I just wouldn't do it. So the house is my kid. This is marvellous. I've had 15 years of loneliness, I promise you. Because anybody who comes into contact with me ends up having a week or so in prison, threatened, punished.
And I have all this.
Sorry?
2 weeks break would be fine.
No, believe me, I have 3 weeks in style prison.
For what?
Nothing. You tell me. No judge, no court, no trial, nothing.
Sounds familiar.
I've had 14 wrongful arrests and false imprisonments. I had 3 weeks in style prison. I was held under 5 different names because I don't exist. And it was only somebody in Canada, after 3 weeks, who made inquiries. Where's Carol Woods? She seems to have disappeared again. They threw me out because all of a sudden the staff are rushing about. They wanted to put my name on the cell door. What is your name? How do you spell it? I said, if you don't know now, I'm not telling you. They wanted me to sign induction forms to pretend I'd just been admitted and I'd gone through the system. I refused to sign. I was very ill. I had shingles in the head and shingles all across the face, stress and worry, because the other inmates couldn't understand, why is she here? Well, what do you think they thought? Because I couldn't tell them why I was there, because there wasn't anything. I had to make up that I was a benefit fraudster because they thought I was in for child abuse of some kind. So I had to make something up.
To protect yourself.
And on just one occasion, in style for example, this is classic, I'm put in a prison van and I'm driven around for 4 hours. Now I'm claustrophobic and I'm sure a lot of people are. I don't know if you've ever been in a prison van, but the little rooms, you've seen them on the streets. With the little windows, each one is a little metal compartment. And I was sat in there. And I was driven around for 4 hours thinking I was going to go absolutely mad because the claustrophobia is really bad. And of course, I don't know where I am and I don't know what they're going to do with me. And then after 4 hours, we were back at style. No, they couldn't unload me because the car was parked wrongly. Until they found out who owned the car, then I had to sit in that van on my own, thinking that I was never ever going to see fresh air again. And whilst I was in style, they showed me the most convenient place to hang myself with my dressing gown belt. On 2 police arrests for failed to attend. Failed to attend what? There's no such thing. I am literally picked up off the street and hidden away somewhere. Sometimes I'm just driven around for hours. I never know where I am and I never know where I'm held. But in 2 police stations, I've been given my shoes and my belt and told to get on with it, my shoelaces and my belt and told to get on with it, and of course I don't. I have been locked up in 5 different mental institutions because I'm a raving lunatic. Now the first time they pulled that stunt was from London because I had a High Court action result. On the 24th of May 2010, Justice Mackay, a senior law lord, told me to go home, forcibly remove anybody in my house, sue them and prosecute them, all on my own. Because I had that result, the justice was also furious about one false court document I showed him. Now I've got a bag full of the damn things. He ordered an inquiry. Of course, I had to disappear again so that I couldn't return for the inquiry. My family had to ring up. They rang the very police who picked me up, kidnapped me. And the police always say, Carol Woods never heard of her. Always say that. I've got that in writing. Oh no, it must be somebody else. No, we've never heard of you. Now on that arrest, I have my driving license with me. But because I'm not me, I don't drive apparently. One of the police officers seeing my driving license said, but this is you. Because they cannot replicate my hair colour. They've had all sorts of people posing as me in court. They cannot replicate my hair colour. Now, I'm sorry, I don't know why I haven't gone grey, and I don't know why I actually haven't fallen out, but anyway, there you go. So that police officer showed me the photograph of me sent to them from Lancashire Police with a different name. No, 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 I'm me. I have never pretended to be anybody else. So, of course, what are they going to do with me? Well, they lock me up in somewhere, I've no idea where. Police station somewhere. Certainly not the one who arrested me. They drive me around a couple of days, I'm just sort of left in limbo. They can't produce me in a court, one, because I haven't done anything, and two, because I'm not the person that they were going to say had done something. What are they going to do with me? Are they just going to let me go? Oh, sorry, Carol, been a big mistake. No, they're not going to let me go. They take me to a mental hospital. I have no idea where I was. Another time, my family report me as a missing person. Never heard about Carol Woods, no. So I'm locked up in a mental hospital. Now, to go into that particular hospital, I had to go, you pass a reception, then it opened out into a large lounge area where there were some very ill people. And I honestly didn't think I was going to survive. I thought, I'm not going to be able to cope with this. But I did. You stay rational, you stay calm, you stay polite, you stay pleasant, and you try and fit in. You sleep when you're supposed to sleep, and you eat when you're supposed to eat, because if you don't, that is proof of your mental illness. Now, after 3 weeks, of course, they didn't know what to do with me because I wasn't mentally ill. They tried to persuade me to admit myself. Why would I do that? So they came in one evening, a psychiatrist, and said, right, you can go. Absolutely torrential rain, you can check it on the internet, what the weather conditions were like. It was August 23rd, 2010, absolutely torrential rain. And I said, where do you think I'm going to go at this time of night? I'm supposed to be mentally ill, remember? And they're telling me to leave. Nowhere to go, don't even know where I am. Torrential rain. So I said, I'm not going. I will wait till tomorrow. And then there was a man in who had some mental health problems, but he wasn't, you know, he wasn't completely ill. He could see what was going on, and he advised me, do not leave without something in writing, because they will arrest you, they will bring you back, say you've run away, and they will sedate you. He said, and that is the start of something really bad. So the next day, I insisted on something in writing. It took between 6 and 7 hours of me sitting there and saying, no, it's all right, Carol, you can go. No, no, no. And it is called a discharge document. So I finally get the discharge document and I leave. But I'm stood outside in this hotel complex thinking, well, what am I going to do now? Except to get away. And then I looked at it. There are lots of blank spaces. These are all in triplicate. She could be writing anything she wanted on her top copy, copied to the second copy, but it's not on my copy. So I went back and I said, I want you now to put not applicable in every blank space or a line through and initial it to show anybody who's looking at this document proof that you have acknowledged every detail. No mental illness, no diagnosis, no medication. There's nothing wrong with me. So what do you think they do? They don't stop at that, because they've made an awful lot of errors. So they do it again to try and get right what they got wrong in the first place. So the second one was another kidnapping. Lewis, 2011. Now I've gone to Lewis because the MP, Norman Baker, was always interested in my case, and he said, if you come and live in Lewis, I can help you. So of course I go to Lewis and things start to happen. And then Norman Baker starts asking questions on the 1st of August 2011, and I disappear on the 3rd. And that disappearance is a van coming round, I'm bundled into a van, told not to speak to anybody. It's the hottest day of the year, check the weather records, 3rd of August 2011, and I am driven round, supposedly mental ill, remember, 7 hours in the boiling heat in the back of a van, sat on the floor, nothing to eat, nothing to drink, no toilet stops. I have no idea where I'm going, I have no idea who these people are, and again, I just have to stay rational and calm. There's nothing else you can do. The idea is they deprive you deliberately of fluid because it dehydrates you. When you're dehydrated, you do become disorientated. And of course, if you don't know where the hell you are disorientated. They are signs that you are mentally ill. I am dumped in a hospital in the north, all the way from Lewis, at midnight that night. And then a woman comes in to speak to me. She's a psychiatrist, Gillian Harrison. And she comes for over 2 weeks, she kept threatening to section me under Section 2 of the Mental Health Act if I did not give her two particular documents. I refused to give her anything. And my answer constantly was, if you haven't got a section, how on earth are you holding me? It's illegal. What I didn't know was, of course, she wasn't a psychiatrist, she was police posing as a psychiatrist. The psychiatrist she was posing as was actually on leave. I mean, I do my homework, I'm not stupid, I just don't make wildcat statements. I do my homework and I check things out. So the real psychiatrist was due back. Well, what are they going to do with me? They move me. And they go and hide me somewhere elsewhere. Another psychiatrist is on leave. So on the 22nd of August 2011, late in the afternoon, I knew they were up to something. I knew it, I can always tell. And I'm never wrong, because a crucial date is the 23rd of October 2008, when police officer Tracy Kennedy impersonated me in Liverpool Magistrates Court, and whatever she was charged with and found guilty of on the 23rd of October 2008 led to the systematic wrecking, looting and seizing of my house 4 days later. Now, I've got all that paperwork. Now, funnily enough, you check with Liverpool Magistrates Court and the court service. There is no record of any hearing that day. So what do you have to do? You're looking at her, because I've got the records. I find things out and I go and I get what I can. So the only things in existence on such a lot of what I say are with me, nobody else. Because records are systematically destroyed. So when I moved to this other hospital, 22nd, early evening, a woman comes in, claims to be a psychiatrist. She may well be. She spoke to me for no more than 5 minutes. Now, bearing in mind, all this depends on assessment. So who the hell's assessed me? Nobody's ever spoken to me. She spends 5 minutes trying to persuade me to let her give me an injection. I said, what on earth for? To try. I said, I'm trying nothing. So she left. Being the 22nd, I knew there's something going on tomorrow, the 23rd. So I stood at the doors of that mental hospital with the bit I had, and I thought, I am not moving, because if there's something going on, somebody from outside is going to be coming in. And they did. There was a young man in there who convened a tribunal for his release. The psychiatrist had to come in to speak to him, so I spoke to her. And of course she says, what are you doing here? Because usually they think I'm a member of staff. I'm not sure if I feel flattered about that or not. What they'd done, and all this is in black and white, they'd pretended that I had admitted myself, which any of you can go and knock on a door and say, please can I come in? And say, oh yes, all right, apparently. They pretended I had admitted myself but I was far more ill than I thought I was. Therefore, they were applying for a Section 2 order to a tribunal. That's what they planned for the 23rd of August 2011 behind my back. But they didn't do it because I was stood at the door and I damn well went into that tribunal and they ordered my immediate release. Now the query there is, if they're only applying for a Section 2 that day, what the hell have they kept me locked up on for the 3 weeks previous? Nothing. It's all bogus. The psychiatrist who wanted to give me an injection, her name is Subramanian, I found out. Subramanian murdered a patient in December 2008 by a lethal injection. She'd been struck off, and I was going to be the next victim. It didn't happen. So when I went there, the hospital tried to persuade me to say they had discharged me. No, 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 a tribunal has ordered my immediate release. You have not discharged me. There's an awful lot of difference. So I walked out of there because a tribunal ordered it, not them. They did not give me a discharge. Meanwhile, of course, I'm still being arrested and locked up in police cells for, it's always failed to attend. But nobody's ever specified what. Now the last horrendous event, because every time I get close to something, on the 7th of November, I was knocked up and I was arrested by PC Andrew Massingham. It was an absolute farce. It's what I refer to as a Keystone Cops, because by this time I know the routine. So I invited him in, I'm ever so pleasant, and because he knocked me up, obviously I was in my night clothes, and a dressing gown, and then he said, would I like to get some clothes on? And I thought, this doesn't sound good at all. And then he said, you'll need a coat. And I said, are you arresting me? And he said, yes, I am. No, he couldn't be specific, but he was still going to arrest me. So I said, this is police harassment. Now, what I've always promised myself I would do, but I didn't, because I was so shocked and upset, and the brain's whirring, thinking, what the hell's going on now? I always promise myself that the next bed copper that does that to me, I'm going to make a citizen's arrest of him and say, you will now accompany me to the police station. Because they don't like any challenges like that. I mean, that would really throw him into confusion, wouldn't you? You've arrested him and he's taking you to the police station anyway, so he has to come with you. That really sickens him. But I said that man was worrying and I knew they were up to something again, because again, I've made some headway. And again, I have to disappear. And each time it gets worse and worse, because they learn from the mistakes they've made in the past, and that is what is really scary. I don't scare easily, but they scare me. The power scares me. So I am arrested and locked up again for 15 hours. I'm deprived of all food and drink as usual, because I'm not really there. They've got a man in, Mr. Carol Woods. And this was really interesting with the earlier conversations of titles. It is absolutely crucial that Lancashire invent me as Mr. Carol Woods. And why they need to invent me as Mr. Carol Woods are two documents in front of Mike Todd, Greater Manchester Police Chief Constable, who was murdered for seeing them and prosecuting on them. And I haven't made that up either. And that's what my case is about. Mike Todd was prosecuting after seeing what I could present in 2007. Now, I cannot prove he was murdered, but any idiot can see that the proof that was presented that he had committed suicide, an 8-year-old can demolish it. So what I say about reasons why he was murdered, I think stand greater weight than anything about him committing suicide. So that's part of my case. And it keeps going back to the whistleblowing. Now then, but this last arrest, after 15 hours, I was offered a drink if I spoke to a medic. Now that's always bad news, because I wanted a drink. Remember, I'd been knocked up early in the morning. I had to remind him to arrest me properly. I had to remind him to read me my rights. It was a complete farce. And I spoke to a medic who asked me, no more than 5 or 6 minutes, Karen Helm, who'd been written right out of the script, because apparently I've made that up as well, she asked me what jobs I'd had after I'd blown the whistle. So I said, well, I did this. Now, I have various qualifications, and I commuted between professions. I'm a qualified, experienced teacher. I don't care what the hell you say. I'm a qualified, experienced teacher. I teach A-level horticulture, and I'm a recognised expert in the teaching of skills for life to such as adult non-readers. I've got vast work in prison departments because I believe that people, adult non-readers, deserve the best staff, and I think in the prisons one can make a great deal of difference. So I'm also a qualified, experienced level 3 social worker, as some people know. So I've worked in child protection as well, and basically I've sort of gone back to teaching. Or so when they forced me out of my job as a whistleblower, because any whistleblower is going to be forced out of the job, I can promise you that, things will start to happen to you. Now, Professor Carey Cooper has done a really good paper on bullying in the workplace, so I don't need to go into that, but anybody who feels they're being victimised at work, look at his document and you'll see, well, that's happened, that's happened, that's happened, and that's happened. And because the more you cope with it in work, what they're throwing at you, the worse it becomes for you, because they hate you even more. And then the personal remarks from, like, they didn't like the way I looked, they didn't like the way I dressed, I walked far too confidently, oh, I do apologise, oh, and I fought for the underdog. Really? Isn't that what you're paying me to do? Well, actually, no, it isn't, but anyway, that's what I took my salary for. So I gave her a list of, well, I did this and I did that, I've got published work on the internet, I'm a researcher, I'm also a recognised expert in qualitative data analysis, which is why they send me code junk, and I can tell you immediately what's wrong with it. And then she said, I was mentally ill, totally deluded, because I only said I had the jobs I said I had. How am I going to prove anything? What have I got with me? Absolutely nothing except my reading glasses and my purse with a little bit of money in it. I've got nothing. So I am totally deluded. Now, just to sort of follow that little bit through, so what? If I want to say I'm the Queen of England, if I'm not harming anybody, you know, but no, I'm totally, that's the mental illness. So after 15 hours of waiting, I am bundled off and locked up in Signet Hospital in Harrogate. And there again, I thought, they're getting this a little bit right this time. I'm out of the area, I've disappeared. Of course, I'm never allowed a phone call at a police station. Don't be silly. Do you think I'm allowed a solicitor?
No.
No. Get real. Nobody knows I am there. So in Signet, this is when the allegations come. Apparently, it was 3:30 in the morning. I walk in there and I said, I am dangerous. I need locking up. And apparently I am dangerous, and I'm a very good actress because other people can't see that danger in me. So, the stuff that was written about me, I was really upset because I thought, how the hell am I going to show anybody this is just not true? One of the things was two members of staff who knew there was something very wrong. And they suggested I'd be allowed to go home at NHS expense and collect proof of any work I have done. Well, I keep everything. Now, the whole deal with wrecking my house was to give them my documents and I could have the house. But they'd still come after the house anyway because I wouldn't be able to prove anything. So I said, no, you keep the house, I'll keep what I've got. So miraculously, I've kept hold of my documents. I know an awful lot of victims. And every word they say is true. They haven't got a scrap of paper to prove it. I've got everything. So they let me go home. And of course, I focus on my work records because that's the delusion. That's why I'm mentally ill. The member of staff with me suggested we take as much as we could carry. When he saw what I've got, he said, let's just take as much as you can carry. He was really good, that staff member. So it was just like a random selection of stuff because I didn't know. I thought, well, we'll go back and we'll see. I can say, right, that's that, that's that, that's that. They're my pay slips. These are my teachers. I'll still get my teacher's pension monthly. I said, why are they paying me that if I was never a teacher? I mean, you know, what they're saying. I said, there's so many holes in your colander, it's like the bottom of a washing up bowl's fallen out. So there was no, sorry, Carol, we've made a mistake. What do you think they did? They changed the delusion. Well, you think important people know of your case, so you're deluded. Well, within the bits of paper I had a letter from Baroness Young of Old Scorn, who's been interested in my case, and the best one of all, Prince Charles. Because Prince Charles was furious that this lot forced me out of my work for the Prince's Trust. I was skills coordinator for the whole Northwest teams. I was highly regarded. When things started to go really, really wrong for me in 04, I knew I had to resign because I thought any slur on me is going to come back on the work I did for the Prince's Trust team, which was part of other work that I was doing. So I had no alternative but to resign and give a false reason. The letter from Prince Charles clearly says, I know why you resigned, that LCC are terrible employers. He said, and I have alerted every team in the Northwest as to why you have really resigned. So I showed that to these medics. And I said, have I made that up? I said, I think he's fairly high profile, but maybe I'm wrong. So they just changed the delusion. And it just goes on and on and on. And then finally, one of them claimed to have phoned my sister, and my sister had apparently said, oh yes, she's going to kill herself, and etc., etc. And I knew he hadn't phoned her, and he had to admit he hadn't actually phoned her. No, you're a liar. Now, within their document, it states that I cannot accept that my house was repossessed by the mortgagee. I have never had a mortgage. That is where the police keep coming in. Well, you must have bought it from the proceeds of crime. So the allegations have been, and this isn't funny, I mean, well, it is funny actually, because I'm actually studying, I'm not locked up somewhere. But, and I kid you not, bank robbery, all on my own. Drug dealing, all on my own. I've been such a successful shoplifter, I managed to pay cash for my house. But in 1998, so I think the police have been a little bit slow at catching me, because they didn't wreck my house till 2008. Now they're claiming, well, she bought it from the proceeds of crime, therefore we could take it off her. But what Norman Baker couldn't get answered was, why did you wreck it? They cannot explain why they systematically wrecked my house. They were drilling walls and all sorts. They were looking for documents and they haven't got them. Now the police officer who has been impersonating me is not actually a police officer, she just poses as one. And I found all this out myself, so I got her perjury. So when Signet started to realise things are not going so well, and Freedom Talk Radio had tracked me down via the same lady who got me out of style prison by asking questions, where's Carol Wood suddenly disappeared to? Because I've been on my own for 15 years. Believe me, you blow the whistle and you won't have a friend inside. This same lady had got onto Freedom Talk Radio. I knew nothing about them. I received one email from them, and the next thing is, I'm being moved. Get your stuff together, you're moving. Now, this was a proper taxi, they were bona fide people, and I was being moved from Signet after 2 months. Now, in that, I had to take some medication because they threatened to force me. Now, I've seen them forcing, where one, they have four members of staff, one at each wrist, one at each ankle, and one injecting, so that's the fifth member. And that is so distressing, and I thought, I can't cope with that. So I had to agree to accept some, but we all have our ways of dealing with things, do we not? So the taxis arrived, and I got my stuff in the taxi, and we set off. Well, not being mentally ill, I know that we weren't going to Lancaster. Now, one of the ladies had put the paperwork on the seat next to me. It wasn't a van, on the floor, it was a taxi, there was a seat, she put some paperwork on the seat next to me. And I looked, it said Durham. And I said, excuse me, why are we going to Durham? And she said, well, that's what, I said, no, I have no contact with Durham, there's something wrong. Why am I going to Durham? I'm from Lancaster. So they were really good, I can't fault them, I wish I knew who they were, can't fault them. She pulled in, made some phone calls, and she said, there's something wrong here, we're going back to Signet. So they took me back to Cigna, and another half hour later she came out, she said, now I have the right paperwork. They were taking me to Durham to disappear and claiming, because CQC were onto them, about the illegal detention of me again, and they were telling CQC Carol Woods has been released. But I, as Carol Woods, was being hidden away under some other name in Durham. And I have no connection with Durham. Nobody would have ever found me. And it was only because she put that paperwork down, and because they were so good, I said, I've no idea who they are. So she said, you're right, you're going to Lancaster. So I went to Lancaster, where they admitted me under Mrs. Carol with an E, Woods. That is not me. That's what the records show. That is me. No, it isn't. And of course, Freedom Talk Radio then start asking questions louder and louder, and it was absolutely brilliant. Goodness only knows what I would have done without those people, because they started badgering and badgering. No, you've got Carol Woods, not this other person. You've got Carol Woods. They were ringing up and ringing up and ringing up. And then the staff said, right, I wasn't allowed to have phone calls. I wasn't allowed to make phone calls. I wasn't allowed visitors. I wasn't allowed to stick my nose out of the door because I wasn't there. Eventually, one of the psychiatrists who had spoken to me, he'd agreed with the police he would release me and the police were going to re-arrest me. But he tipped me off and he said, well, we are going to release you, but Sergeant Philip Spence is going to arrest you. I said, what for? I wasn't surprised, but I thought, well, I've been locked up for 3 months. They haven't got the result they wanted, so what is he going to arrest me for? And again, it was Freedom Talk Radio and various other people putting it out over the press. Sergeant Philip Spencer is going to re-arrest Carol Woods. And there was a massive climb down. They were going to leave me alone. But my worry was, now I don't know if anybody of you know of Pauline Campbell. She was a campaigner for rights in prisons because she had one daughter and her daughter was arrested, but not disputing the arrest was wrong or anything. But she was locked up in Stile prison and she committed suicide the first night. Now Pauline Campaign, and she was like me, she was a little bit older than me, she was a teacher like myself, same height, same build. There wasn't much to her. And every single time she was campaigning legally outside of prison, she was arrested. So Pauline had 8 arrests. Now on the last arrest, and the producer in court, the Crown Prosecutor was Ian Rushton, an old enemy of mine. The police claimed that she was handcuffed behind her back because she had attacked 2 police officers. She was the one with the bruises. Pauline declared perjury. Massive climb down from Ian Rushton all over the press. The next day, Pauline was found dead. She did not commit suicide, she'd been sending me emails, she was overjoyed, high-spirited, she wasn't depressed. Pauline was knocked off because there'd been a climb down. So of course, I leave the orchard in Lancaster and I was really scared. I thought, is this going to be a Pauline Campbell? Well, it hasn't been, and that's because I just sort of don't walk into as many traps. I mean, they set traps. The police harassment never stops, never stops. A great deal is about setting traps for me, and it's about the house. Now, if anybody looks on the bankruptcy website, it will show that I am bankrupt. I am not bankrupt, because people are asking questions. How can this lady lose £400,000 worth of assets in an afternoon? But I thought the mortgagee had repossessed my house. Derek Wyatt MP asked, but who let her get £400,000 worth of debt? I have never owed a penny. And I've got all the documents to prove that. I've got the documents to prove that bogus bankruptcy. Now, Lancashire County Council are trying to do that because they want more than anything else. In a bankruptcy, you have to hand in all your documents. LCC can't bankrupt anybody. They have no corporate personality and know the law on bankruptcy. Now then, because it was over £50,000, we're talking about £400,000, it has to go to the High Court. can't be dealt with in a local court with no court seals on the junk that they dish out. So this just carries on. Now, there was no record of any bankruptcy. Somebody now is asking questions yet again, and all of a sudden, it's appearing on the internet that I am bankrupt. Well, no, I'm not. So my documents prove extortion. If a government department, or anybody in fact, but a government department tells you you owe money, knowing that you do not owe that money, that is extortion. It is also fraud. There's got to be forgery, because in any bankruptcy, I had to have signed all kinds of stuff, and I've signed nothing. So there's got to be forgery. It's also demanding money with menaces, because of what I put up with for 15 years. Now, it escalated particularly 04, 05 and 06. And a friend of mine, who was still with me at the time, Daisy May Morrison, the victim of terrible racism in work, which I'd supported her through for years, to get her some sort of settlement, which we did, but she did get a breakdown in that as well. She had a mental breakdown, and it's hardly surprising. But Daisy May parked her brand new car outside my house January 2006, and I had a big appeal coming up. And when we went out, they deliberately rammed it, and they'd written it off for her. The police wouldn't give her a crime number. She lost all that money on a car. It just goes on and on and on. I'm in another police station where I've been cheated out of £2,000 by a local solicitor, so I felt, this was local to Leeds, I felt I was in my right to report it to the police. So my sister accompanies me, Leeds, Holbeck Police Station, and I report this solicitor, who actually turns out not to have been a solicitor either. And I was being interviewed by Leeds Police. I was being interviewed by a Lancashire inarticulate yob who told me that if I did not cease my case, something would happen to a close relative. The next person to be arrested on a bogus, trumped-up charge was my brother, who nearly had a breakdown, because he's a really, really decent man. And he's an engineer who works for Network Rail. He'd had his job, you know, all his life. He's dead steady, my brother. But no, they went after him. And my brother was so upset he couldn't cope, and he paid up and shut up, because he had to end it somehow. Now, I've got his file papers, and what we were going to expose, again, was perjury. Oh, I'm an expert on perjury, 1911 Act. But apparently, according to one judge, I've made it up all on my own. I'm very clever. I can get laws through the House of Parliament years before I was even born. And I can establish case law as well years before I was born. But I can't produce my brother's paperwork unless I ask him, and he's no mortgage, he's scared to death. So anybody without a mortgage, and if you've only got a small mortgage, for God's sake, don't pay it off, because they will have your house. They will pull the rug from under you, especially if they know who you are. And I suspect that every single person in this room is known to somebody at some level somewhere. Right, so don't pay off a mortgage, and just look out for false court documents, threats, any sort of all these wrongful arrests and stuff. I have no idea where you take all this, because I've tried and tried and tried. I've applied for orders of mandamuses in court, and then you get the court staff posing as judges, and nobody has got the false court document evidence that I have. I don't care who you are, you might have one or two pages and be absolutely wonderful examples. Nobody's got what I've got. And my problem is, the bulk of them were in front of Mike Todd, Greater Manchester Police Chief Constable, who in March 2008 passed my file to Ian Rushton. Oh, we've just heard his name, haven't we? Ian Rushton, Chief Crown Prosecutor, Manchester CPS, Key Street, Sunlight House. So that's because I refuse to do something in work. Now, the whistleblowing, it's not just about child protection issues, because some of the other issues I blew the whistle on with other families, I mean, it was appalling, because to go after me, to discredit my work, they went after some of my clients, which is totally unforgivable. Absolutely unforgivable. And if I can highlight anything for those families, of course, the children aren't small anymore, they've grown up, but those children deserve a payout. because of what they suffered simply because I was a social worker and my work was to be discredited. But the original whistleblowing of the illegal seizure of 134 acres of land in Blackpool, which I warned, if you carry on doing this in the way you are doing it, and it is illegal because you don't own that land, something will happen that will be so serious it attracts media attention. And on the 30th of June 2003, only 3 months after I'd warned of that, sorry, 2001, and on the 21st of April 2001, I'd warned of such an event, Sheila Bridge was murdered. And she was murdered as a direct result of what the county was doing to seize the land. To seize the land, they had to close 4 homes for disturbed adolescent boys. Now we're talking about dangerous children. My involvement was I had 4 young boys on the site in those homes. They had nowhere else to live, it was their home. So I appeal on human rights grounds, if nothing else. Article 8 of the Human Rights Act applies. Now that was put on page 3 of a particular document of mine, which page 3 disappeared. Well, it would, wouldn't it? Now that was when I first started to get an inkling, there's something going on here. So Sheila Bridges murdered because the children were still dispersed into a community that no field social workers, no community support, so they left her run wild. And they recruited a teenage gang and murdered her. Not intentionally, but it was corporate manslaughter. So that was my first letter to the county. I think you should be charged with corporate manslaughter. I told you that would happen. That's when the first senior cop was on my doorstep, veiled threats. Time to consider your health. Something's wrong with me. What about your children? I said, how do you know I've got children? And then he said, you can't win, it's coming from the government. And I said, get real, the government doesn't know I exist. Well, unfortunately it did. Because what I didn't know 2 days earlier than his threats, because of everything I'd predicted had come true, LCC had rushed off to the High Court to appeal to the High Court to seize the land and close the boys' homes. Yeah? They were pretending that they'd done that prior to Mrs. Bridges' death, which would have meant she wasn't the victim of corporate manslaughter. Right? Now this is where it gets complicated because people can't understand, well how can they do it after the event? Because it's called revision history, they do it all the time, all the time. That's why they keep locking me up in mental hospitals, because that didn't happen, we're redoing it again, and then we're redoing it again, and then that becomes the actual one example. They had gone to the High Court to seek permission to do everything I've told them they couldn't do anyway. They lost their appeal. They lost it for the same legal grounds I have made myself. Who do you think was their representative that day in the High Court? Perjuring herself, lying to the court, forgetting to tell the bench. Oh, we've already done this, sorry, we've just forgot to mention it. Who do you think was their representative? Sherry Blair? So when this cop is on my doorstep saying, you can't win, it's coming from the government, he actually wasn't kidding. So that is who I was up against. Now then, of course, what did he want 134 acres of land for? Wasn't I naive? Where is it? Just outside Blackpool. What was in the pipeline? Fracking. The super casino. No, no, no. Before the fracking, it is fracking now. It was the super casino. And I've been told, Carol, do you really think that they were just going to siphon off a few £1,000 here and there for holidays? No. They were going to use the money to fund other crime. He said, that's who you've upset. Now that explains this massive, massive input of monies to get at me. And I'm talking about serious amounts of monies in buying cars for people. And then when I work out what's going on, that car disappears and they have another car. These are long-term unemployed people who end up with personalised number plates on very nice cars. I can't afford one. You should see the state of my car where they tried to run me off the road, deliberately rammed me. I don't have the bodywork repaired, because that's my evidence. I need things like a new exhaust, etc., and that kind of stuff. But I don't worry about the bodywork. My car's crucial, because my car says I'm me, it's my driving licence. Now, I didn't have that car because my earlier car in 2009 just simply disappeared. And I found it at the police garage, just completely dismantled. This particular car I bought in January 2012. And it's registered to me because I'm me. And the attempts to steal it, to force me to change the lock to pretend I've stolen it. The garage, I've had a wheel loosened, not a tyre, I've had a wheel loosened, petrol tank deliberately ruptured. I mean, you name it, they've done it. And they're actually suggesting now that I'm indestructible. So we've had heavy medication of dangerous drugs. I mean, they've tried that a few times. You know, I mean, all the car stuff. They've attempted, I rented a caravan briefly in 2012 at 298 Oxford Road Morgan, and it was a culture shock for me, but I was sick of living in my car. I'd exhausted friends and family because they know I'm on the doorstep, trouble arrives. I stay away from people because it's the only way to protect people. And there were three attempts to cause a gas explosion at my caravan using the colour gas. There were four attempts at tampering with the electrical system underneath the caravan where the feed came in, and that blew up four electric meters. The fire service always refused to come. Now, when the first Greater Manchester Police raided my house at first on the 5th of September 2008, they assumed they would find enough documents to then leave me alone, but they found nothing because there wasn't anything in the house and I wasn't there. But they'd wrecked all my utilities. It's classic, it's what they do. And of course, the fire service wouldn't come. I had to pay for it all to be repaired myself. And that is what they do. And then I set the caravan. And even now, I mean, a classic is to knock off my water overnight so that I get up in the morning, you turn your hot tap on, it's linked to your gas boiler, no water, boo. Their problem is they didn't know I only have cold water in the morning. So that didn't work. And it just goes on and on and on. This is about mostly the house, because the house is such a concrete thing. They can, like, they've invented new bankruptcy papers. But the Ministry of Justice confirmed to me only recently there's no records in my name. So where have they come from? But let's suppose you've got a chief constable somewhere else looking at my case. The first thing he will do is look at the bankruptcy website and say, well, it's there, she's making it up. He's not going to waste his time saying to me, well, Carol, how do you dispute this? He's just going to think, well, that's fact. And that's how it is. And then the usual thing is you try and complain about anything, and they say it's confused, far too much. Anything to disparage your written work. Anything at all. And that is to imply you've got a mental health problem. So when they can't go down the criminal route, they go down the mental health route. Anyway, I came today because I knew that Guy Taylor was going to be here, and he said it's time for me to copy out some of my documents to any brave soul who will keep a copy, because the next time I disappear, I might not be so damn lucky, I might not be able to go home to get anything, in which case they will just disappear. So somebody checked on the website, there's plenty of places that will do photocopying. So I brought some crucial documents. So if anybody's brave enough, I can get some copies and they can keep them for me.
Right here, sweetheart.
Hello, Alvin.
Right, thank you. So.
Debt Free TV, in association with getoutofdebtfree.org.